Now, in this part 5 of the discussion on Bohr-Eitel model, I will consider what happens when we take into account the finite mass of the nucleus. Okay. In the original derivation of Bohr-Eitel model, Bohr assumed that since the mass of the nucleus is very heavy compared to the mass of the electron, nucleus is stationary, only electron is moving around the nucleus. But we know that mass of the nucleus is not infinitely large. Okay, even though it is larger than that of the electron, it's finite. So when you consider the effect of the finite mass of the nucleus, then we have to take into account the fact that both nucleus and electron are revolving. So the actual situation is something like this. If this is the axis passing through the center of mass of the nucleus electron system, then this naturally the center of mass will be closer to the nucleus compared to the electron, because nucleus is heavier than that of the electron. We are talking about again hydrogen atom. So the nucleus is revolving around this center of mass. Let us say the mass of the nucleus is m2 at a distance, or let me say mass of the nucleus, I am taking m1 at a distance r1 from the center of mass. It is revolving at a distance r1 from the center of mass, and electron is also revolving around the center of mass at a distance r2. Okay, so both are revolving. So this is the actual situation. Nucleus is also moving about the common center of mass, and electron is also moving about the common center of mass, and the center of mass is nearer to the nucleus. So this is nucleus, this is m1, and this is electron. So this is the actual situation. Then how do we take into account the effect of nuclear motion? So this is what we are going to discuss. Effect of nuclear motion. Okay, so because I am redrawing it in another way. Suppose this is our coordinate system with this origin. This is the position of the nucleus, this is the position of the electron, this is the line joining them, and this is the center of mass, somewhat closer to the nucleus. Now if I consider different position vectors of these three points, suppose the position vector of nucleus is some r1 prime, okay, position vector of the electron is r2 prime, and position vector of the center of mass is some capital R. Okay. Then what is the, with respect to the point O, okay, what are the moments of these two particles? Moment of mass m1 is m1 r1 prime. Moment of mass m2 is m2 r2 prime. Okay. Now the definition of center of mass is that the moments of the two masses is equal to the moment of the center of mass. So it is as if the total mass of the system is concentrated at a point which we call center of mass. Then if the total mass is apparently concentrated here, then what is the moment of this point m1 plus m2 r? That is the definition of center of mass. Now, suppose we shift the origin of the coordinate system to this point, from O to the center of mass. So, with respect to center of mass, what is the situation? First of all, when you shift the origin to the center of mass, r is equal to 0. Okay, the position vector of the center of mass becomes 0. So now imagine that our coordinate system is here. Okay, this is the origin. Then what is the position vector of m1? This is the position vector of m1. Let us use the symbol r1 for that. This is the position vector of m2. Let us use the symbol r2 for that. Okay, and we can see that r2 and r1 are mutually opposite to each other. So r is equal to 0 and r1 prime goes to r1. Okay, r2 prime goes to r2. So since they are opposite to each other, if this direction is positive, you have to put this direction as negative. So we can say r1 prime goes to minus r1. R2 prime goes to R2. Then what happens to this equation? This equation becomes M1, instead of R1 prime we have minus R1. So minus M1 R1 plus M2, instead of R2 prime we have R2. So M2 R2 is equal to, since capital R is now 0, we have 0 here. So we have the equation, I will write here, M1 R1 minus M2 R2 equal to 0. Let us call it equation 1. This is the relation between the moments of the two particles in this type of a picture. So here our origin is at the center of mass. M1 R1 is the moment of nucleus. M2 R2 is the moment of the electron. And this is the relationship between them. M1 R1 minus M2 R2 equal to 0. Now, in addition, let me use another condition. Let us say R1 plus R2 is equal to R. Okay, separation between electron and nucleus. R is the separation between electron and nucleus. And from the figure, R is equal to R1 plus R2. Now, this is two relations between R1 and R2. Okay, this is one equation. This is another equation. Now, using these two relations, I can get expressions for R1 and R2 in terms of R. Okay, let us see. Now, suppose we eliminate R2 from the both equations. In order to eliminate R2, what we can do is, let us multiply second, it is called equation 2. Let us multiply second equation with M2 and then add with equation 1. Okay. So, if you multiply second equation with M2, you have a M2 R2 here. If you add with 1, it will cancel. So, if you multiply this with M2 and add with 1, what you have here is M1 plus M2 into R1 is equal to, you have multiplied second, here this will cancel. Okay. Here we have M2 R. So, R1 is equal to M2 divided by M1 plus M2 into R. This is R1. Call it equation 3. Now, here we have eliminated R2 to get the expression for R1 in terms of R. Similarly, let us eliminate R1. How do we eliminate R1? Let us multiply equation 2 with M1. Okay. Then subtract 1 from 2, 2 minus 1. Then this term will cancel. We have M1 R2 minus minus M2 R2. So we have M1 plus M2 into R2 is equal to M1 R. So eventually what we get is R2 is equal to M1 R by M1 plus M2. Question 4. You verify that. So what you have to do is multiply equation 2 with M1 and subtract 1 from 2. Find 2 minus 1 after multiplying this with M1. We get this. Okay. Now coming back to here. What is the moment of inertia of this system? Okay, so moment of inertia about the center of mass, about the vertical axis passing through the center of mass, is moment of inertia of the nucleus m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square. Right? Now what I am doing is, instead of r1, let me substitute equation 3. So what you get? m2 square r square divided by m1 plus m2 whole square plus m2 into, instead of r2 I am substituting equation 4. So we have m1 square r square divided by m1 plus m2 whole square. So if I take m1 m2 r square by m1 plus m2 r square outside, m1 m2 r square by m1 plus m2 r square I can take out because it is common in both terms. So here if we take m1 m2 r square by m1 plus m2 r square, what is remaining is 1 m2. Here if you take m1 m2 r square by m1 plus m2 r square outside, what is remaining is m1. So 1 m1 plus m2 will cancel. What you have is m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into r square. So moment of inertia of the system about the center of mass is this. Now this term in the square bracket, it has a dimension of mass. Okay, in the numerator you have mass square, in the denominator you have mass, so it has a dimension of mass. So let me put some m prime instead of this term. So moment of inertia about the center of mass is this. Okay, let us call this as equation 5 and this as equation 6. So what is the difference between equation 5 and equation 6? Equation 5 gives you this type of a picture. Okay, nucleus is revolving about the center of mass, about the distance r1, so its moment of inertia is m1 r1 square. Electron is revolving around the center of mass, about the distance r2, so its moment of inertia is m2 r2 square. Okay, so this is the picture obtained from this equation. What type of, now we can see that the same equation we can rewrite like this. Now when you look at this equation, you see that two particles are revolving, nucleus and electron, about the common center of mass. When you look at this equation, it is the same equation rewritten in terms of m prime and r. When you look at this equation, you see only one mass. Okay, so it is like, what type of a picture emerges from this equation? A picture, you can say something like this. This is the picture that you obtain from this equation, from equation 6. Okay, what is this picture? A particle of mass m prime is revolving about a center at a distance r from the center. That's all. What is this r? So this is like a single particle motion. Okay, so what we have done is, a two particle motion is reduced to a one particle motion. Or basically say that a two body problem is reduced to a one body problem. Okay, this type of a picture is reduced to this type of a picture. What is this particle? It is neither electron nor the nucleus. It contains the mass of both the electron and the nucleus. See, what is the mass? m1 m2 by m1 plus m2. Okay, so it contains the mass of both the nucleus and the electron. And what is this distance r? It is the separation between electron and the nucleus. Okay, the separation between electron and the nucleus. So even though we have considered the motion of the nucleus as well as the electron, the final equation, for if you look at the expression for moment of inertia, we see that it can be rewritten in the form of the motion of a single particle. Okay, any two body problem we can reduce to one body problem. Okay, then we want to see what are the changes in the expressions that we have derived in Bohr atom model. What changes will be there for each equation when the effect of nuclear motion is taken into consideration. Now we see that in Bohr model, what was the picture of Bohr model? A picture something like this. Okay, electron is revolving around the nucleus. Nucleus is stationary. Electron is revolving around the nucleus at a distance r. So this distance r was in Bohr model, in the original Bohr model, where the nucleus was assumed to be stationary. The distance r was the distance between electron and the central nucleus, right? Now in this reduced, in this type of picture, what is this distance r? It is again the distance between electron and nucleus. R is nothing but r1 plus r2. Okay, so this distance r is also the distance between electron and the nucleus, just like in Bohr's original picture. So the only difference is that instead of the mass of the electron, we have to use this mass. Now this mass has the property that m prime is less than m1 and m prime is less than m2. It is less than both the individual masses. Okay, so that is, therefore this mass is called reduced mass, since it is less than mass of the nucleus as well as mass of the electron. It is called reduced mass. So the only change that we need to do in taking into effect the motion of the nucleus is that instead of electron mass, you just change it by reduced mass. Okay, this distance r of electronic orbit is the same in this equivalent picture. R is the distance between the electron and the nucleus here also. So the only difference is change the electronic mass by reduced mass. Now let us see how much is this difference. Okay. So before looking at the actual equations, the changes in different physical quantities, let us see how the presence of reduced mass is what type of change, what type of how much quantitative change will happen here. So I am writing reduced mass in another way. It is m1 into by m1 plus m2, right? So instead of m1 is the mass of the nucleus, if you look at the previous figure. So instead of m1, let me write capital M. Instead of m2 is the mass of the electron, let me simply write small, okay, because we have used m for the mass of the electron in previous calculations using Bohr model. So divided by m1 plus m2, so capital M plus small. So capital M is m1, mass of the nucleus. Small m is m2, mass of the electron. Okay. Now what is m prime by m? I am taking m to the left side. So we have capital M by m plus small m. If we take capital M outside from numerator and denominator, this is equal to 1 by capital M. If I take out from numerator and denominator, it will cancel. So 1 by 1 plus small m by capital M. Okay, we have m prime by m is equal to 1 by 1 plus small m by capital M. If capital M is infinity, okay, the mass of the nucleus is infinitely large, this term is zero. So m prime is equal to m. So this is what we have assumed in the previous calculation when we assumed that the nucleus is stationary. Okay, when we assume that nucleus is stationary, effectively what we are arguing is that mass of the nucleus is infinitely large compared to the mass of the electron. Okay. So if mass of the nucleus is large, infinitely large, then this term capital M will be infinity, this term will be zero, m prime is equal to m, reduced mass is equal to mass of the electron. Since m is finite, we can say m prime is less than m, reduced mass is less than mass of the electron. Now in the case of hydrogen atom, okay, for hydrogen atom, If you look at this expression, let me try to see some quantitative value. What is capital M mass of the nucleus? Now we know that in hydrogen atom, nucleus contains only one proton, right? Mass of this proton, M is nothing but mass of the proton. Mass of the proton is 1836 times mass of the electron, approximately. Okay, more correctly we can say 1836.1. Then this m prime by m becomes, so this is 1836, this is also 1836 times small m. Here also you can put 1836 times small m. So essentially what we have is 1836 small m will cancel. Here 1836 times small m plus small m. So we have 1837. This is the ratio. And this is, this value is, more correctly we can put a 0.1 also. So this value will be, if I put that 0.1 also, 1836.1, here also 0.1. Okay, this is more correct. So what you get is 0.9994556. Up to 8 decimal points. Okay. So m prime is less than m by this factor. Okay. So this is a decrease of, you see, if you take the separation between m and m prime. Okay. We can, if you take m minus m prime, the value is approximately 0.00055, or if you m minus m prime, since m prime is less than m, right, m minus m prime is this much. Okay, so if you consider this m minus m prime by m into 100, the percentage change, okay, then this m will come here, and if you multiply with 100, what you have is 0.055%. Okay, so electronic mass is greater than the reduced mass by this much, or we can say the reduced mass is less than electronic mass by this much. This is the difference in the case of hydrogen atom. Okay, because we have, in this calculation, we have used, instead of capital M, we have used 1836.1 times mass of the electron. That means we have assumed that there is only one proton in the nucleus. Okay, if it is some other atom, then the value will be different, the percentage will be different. So for hydrogen atom, this much change is there. Electronic mass is greater than reduced mass by 0.055%. Reduced mass is less by 0.055%. Now with this idea, let us see what is the, I want to see what is the change in energy in the case of hydrogen atom. So let us look at the expression for energy. So, so what is the expression for energy? This we have calculated before. The expression for energy in terms of, including the term mass, is minus m e raised to 4 by, there is an n square here. Okay, this was the expression. Now if m is replaced by m prime, okay, then En prime, energy will be En prime is equal to minus m prime e raised to 4 divided by n square 8 epsilon 0 square x square. Okay, this we can write as m prime by m into minus m e raised to 4 by n square 8 epsilon 0 square x square, correct? I'm just multiplying numerator and denominator with m. Now this term in this bracket is this thing. Okay, so we can say En prime is equal to m prime by m into En. Remember, En is negative. So what happens to energy? We know that m prime by n is some less than 1, but En is negative. Okay, so this is less than 1. And En is negative, that means it becomes less negative. Okay, you are multiplying En with the value 0.9945. Okay, so this becomes less negative, that means energy increases. So energy increases. You have to take into consideration the fact that En is negative. So since you, instead of m, if you replace with m prime, you know, or for example, if you compare these two expressions, okay, you have some energy here, and here your m is replaced with m prime is less than m, then the energy becomes less negative and the energy increases. Energy increases by 0.055% in the case of hydrogen. Now let us see the situation of spectral lines also. In the case of spectral lines, first we have to look at the Rydberg formula. Rydberg formula is minus E1 by Hc. Okay. So when you take minus E1, you are taking the numerical value of E1. What happens to the numerical value if you take the minus En or minus En prime? If you look at the numerical value decreases when m is replaced by m prime. Okay, so minus E1 is actually decreasing. So this means that Rydberg constant decreases. When Rydberg constant decreases, lambda increases by the same factor. So Rydberg constant decreases, and Rydberg constant is proportional to 1 by lambda. Right, and the expression for 1 by lambda r appears. So when Rydberg constant decreases, lambda increases. So when you take into account the effect of nuclear motion, then energy values decrease, and energy values increase by this factor. Rydberg constant decreases and lambda increases. Okay, energy and wavelength values increases. Now this has an interesting application. We can detect the presence of isotopes by looking at the way, we know what are isotopes. Isotopes are atoms of the same element having different atomic masses. Okay, atomic number is the same. So if atomic number is the same, number of protons in the nucleus is the same, number of electrons in the orbits are the same, but at mass number is different. Mass number is different because number of neutron number in the nucleus is different. For example, hydrogen has three isotopes are there. Consider hydrogen and deuterium. Okay, here both are having atomic number 1. That means there is only one proton and there is only one electron in both hydrogen and deuterium. But in deuterium, in addition to one proton, there is one neutron in the nucleus. So the size of the mass of the nucleus is double, almost double than that of hydrogen nucleus. So this type of presence of isotopes can be detected by the shift in the spectral lines. For example, if you take into account this reduced mass idea. Let us consider how we can detect this, how we can explain this in the case of hydrogen and deuterium. See, if we consider hydrogen and deuterium, let us compare the reduced mass of hydrogen and deuterium. For example, the expression for m prime is, we can write it like this, 1 plus small m by capital M, where capital M is the mass of the nucleus, right? For hydrogen, the reduced mass is this, where M, capital M, H is the mass of hydrogen nucleus. For deuterium, where M, capital M, D is the mass of deuterium nucleus. Now we know that mass of deuterium nucleus is greater than that of hydrogen nucleus, right? MD is greater than MH, double, almost double that of MH. So if M, this is greater, then this will be, if this is greater, then what happens to this? This is a smaller quantity, right? Then MD will be greater. So we have, this implies the reduced mass of deuterium will be greater than reduced mass of hydrogen, correct? Because nuclear mass is greater. If this is greater than this one, this M by MD will be smaller than M by MH. So denominator will be smaller, so the reduced mass will be higher, right? Now if this is greater, then we can say Rydberg constant for deuterium is greater than Rydberg constant for hydrogen, right? Because MD prime appears in the numerator of Rydberg constant. So if reduced mass is greater for deuterium, Rydberg constant is greater. If Rydberg constant is greater, then the wavelength of each spectral line in deuterium will be less than that of the corresponding spectral line hydrogen. I can put there is no prime here. Wavelength will be less. For example, if we look at the X alpha line, the first line in the Balmer series in hydrogen and deuterium, X alpha line, it is 656.3 nanometer in hydrogen, whereas X alpha line for deuterium is 656.1 nanometer. There is a difference of a shift of 0.2 nanometer. Now this shift can be experimentally measured, and this was how the presence of deuterium was detected in 1932 in the spectrum, in the hydrogen spectrum. Two closely spaced H alpha lines were seen. One was at 656.3 nanometer, the other 656.1 nanometer. And this is explained to be that of deuterium. And this difference can be exactly calculated by substituting the values of the nuclear mass of hydrogen and deuterium. And this was detected by in 1932 by an American physicist, Harold Urey, American chemist, Harold Urey. So he discovered a discovery of deuterium. So this is an application of the detection of isotopes. Is an application of taking into effect taking into consideration the effect of nuclear motion. So that concludes our discussion on Bohr atom model. So we have discussed how starting with in the five parts we have discussed how starting with the three postulates Bohr derived the expression for different quantities related to hydrogen atom, orbital radius, orbital speed, and total energy of the hydrogen atom, then the Rydberg formula of wavelength of spectral lines, then frequency of revolution of the electron in the orbit, and then from the Rydberg formula we can derive the wavelength of different spectral series, Lyman, Balmer, Paschen, Brackett, Fun, Humphrey. And these spectral series can be were derived. Then then in the third part we discussed how Bohr extended his theory to hydrogenic atom or hydrogen-like atoms, and explained the presence of certain lines in solar spectrum as spectral lines of ionized helium, singly ionized helium. Then we also discussed how Bohr explained that while some of the lines present in the emission spectrum are absent in the absorption spectrum. Then we also saw how Bohr introduced the idea of electronic shell structure. Then in part 4 we discussed how Bohr introduced the idea of correspondence principle, and using this correspondence principle how he obtained the condition for angular momentum quantization. Okay, we have also discussed how we can invert the argument, right? Then in the last part, in part 5, we considered the effect of nuclear motion and how this changes the different expressions. In particular, we have seen in hydrogen atom, energy increases, Rydberg constant decreases, and therefore lambda increases by a factor, a very small factor, 0.055%. That factor will be different in other atoms. And we have seen that this idea can be applied to detect the presence of isotopes from the spectra. So that concludes our discussion. It's a rather long session on Bohr atom model. Thank you.